Welcome to the relocation to that secret island within. We can make a relocation within. I certainly will do that. There's a revelation at this time, right at the time of collapse. The time of collapse is coming in the world for sure. We don't realize what's going to take place, but we can relocate to the perfect island within the stalemate, where we experience this blissful stalemate. Where nothing is really happening. It's stalemated. And this place is within us. It's within our mind. Now there may be a physical relocation as well. But I would say it's first the inner relocation, where we realize that this perfect stalemate can only be there for spirit. Only spirit can appreciate it. Therefore, since we are appreciating it, we must be spirit. We are greater than the mind, as it were. We are the ones who tell the mind what we want to experience, not vice versa. So we realize that the play of the mind that is taking place, and the stalemate, this play of the stalemate, is for us. For us to see, for us to experience. And so we must be therefore greater than the mind, as it were. Primary, spirit. Mind is the servant of spirit. Mind is the movie maker. So we're watching a movie, but who is watching the movie? There's this beautiful movie of a stalemate, which perfect stalemate, which reminds us of reality. But who is watching the movie? And we begin to remember, I must be spirit. This perfection. And this perfection reminds me of my home. So we say, I must be spirit. I'm remembering my home. I'm remembering reality. And it goes like that. Something very interesting happened this morning. I was walking right near where I am right now. And suddenly something seemed to come down from the tree. I thought something might have dropped from the tree or something. I said, and it landed right on my chest here. Boom. I looked down. I said, what in the world is that? It's a piece of bark? No. And I realized it's a creature of some sort. And I said, well, it must be a spider, a big spider. I said, whoa, it didn't seem like a spider. This is weird. The whole thing was very strange. And I looked down, looked at it carefully. I said, my God, it's a gigantic mosquito. Gigantic. I mean, it must have been 5 times bigger than a normal mosquito. It was the biggest mosquito I've ever seen in my life. And I just pulled my shirt like that, brushed it off or whatever, and it went off like that. But it was rather unnerving. It's like a mosquito on steroids. A monster mosquito. What a sign, huh? What a sign from above. Showing that, what do mosquitoes do? They suck the blood out of us, don't they? They innervate us. This world is going to be attacked by gigantic mosquitoes, as it were. Taking all the energy out of it. So, indeed, great changes are coming. And we know about the re-education and all of the various things that are going to take place. But we can relocate. The internal relocation within can manifest as an external relocation as well. That would be expected. Now we're not You see, because of the continuity issue, we are not... Nothing is being lost or attacked or anything like that. We're just enjoying the movie of a stalemate. No winners, no losers. The dance of death is getting nowhere. It's stalemated. It's still there, but it's having no effect on no formation. So it's a stalemate. It loses its meaning and purpose. It's a stalemate. That becomes the meaning and purpose that we're watching. Ah, this is a beautiful, perfect stalemate. How wonderful. How wonderful. And when we're able to understand what it is we're seeing, it enables us to abide in that seeing then. Whereas if we don't have any context, we catch a glimpse of this and then we'll attach all sorts of symbols, concepts, words, etc. We'll attach it, we'll throw it all up there and say, maybe this is what it was. I don't know, but this might be it. And we're lost in this vast swamp of interpretation. But if we understand that what it is, it's this perfect stalemate, we don't have any reason to go any further than that. Just say, ah, just an ah. This is what it is, okay. Just enjoy it. Ramana said, abide in the self. don't interpret this perfect stalemate. Don't try to copy it. Don't try to reverse engineer it. Don't try to do anything at all with it. Just enjoy it. Just enjoy it. And of course, the only emotion, feeling, whatever there is, it would be bliss from that. Because everything else is stalemated. That comes from this stalemate, gives rise to this feeling, this blissful calm, as it were. So this inner island is this blissful, calm place that is so beautiful and serene. The Holy Spirit makes the stalemate seem very beautiful also. Very, very beautiful. It's a perfect, beautiful stalemate. There's no reason not to. So what it does, it makes everything appear to be extremely beautiful. All this dance of impermanence is incredibly beautiful. And yet it's still stalemated. So that gives us a double benefit, because that reminds us of reality too. So we say, nothing is really happening at all. Nothing is really happening at all. There's everything happening, but nothing happening. This is the paradox that you hear the mystics talk about. That's because of the stalemate. Two sides of one coin. It takes two to have a stalemate. So everything is happening. This dance of impermanence is happening. And yet this perfect non-dance is happening also. So everything is happening and nothing is happening. And you have no idea which is going to win or prevail. It's a stalemate. It's a stalemate. So there's only this feeling of bliss. So I can't wait. I can't wait for that. This is terrific. The sooner the better, the sooner the better, the sooner this relocation happens, the better. And of course it's going to bail everybody out, so to speak. Those around you, you know. And you might say, hey look, I mean, I don't think you deserve to be bailed out really, but it's the Holy Spirit, it's up to the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit's bailed everyone out. So you're bailed out too. It'll be very beneficial to your friends and family and all those and those you don't even know, those you know and those you don't even know. It would be very beneficial, actually, extremely so. Bail them out, because they're really in trouble. There's no question. I'm not aware of those who are seeing this, you know, clearly at all. They've squandered their time, they've been lazy. They're easily carried away with distraction and anger, etc., getting pulled down. That's, you know. And so, but they'll get bailed out, too. To some extent, they'll be helped. And from our standpoint, I'm sure there's a lot of people we think, well, they don't really deserve that. They've wasted their time. They're not, you know, they're just completely absorbed by all this conflict and the ego, etc. But to some extent, they will be definitely helped. Well, good. Whoever the Holy Spirit wants to help, that's fine. It's not up to us. If it was up to us, for sure, we would say that there's some we'd rather and don't deserve it, right? But no, it's up to the Holy Spirit. Whatever it wants to do is fine. So we better start bailing people out, because they're in big trouble. Easily they get pulled into this game that the ego is doing. It's very tricky. Very tricky. If they're not focused on this relocation into this perfect island, blissful haven, where the perfect stalemate is, we're aware of it. See, it's a blissful haven within us. There's a blissful haven within us. If they're not aware of that, the big mosquitoes are going to descend upon them and start biting them very badly. Now, they'll get bit for sure, but they won't feel it so bad. Just like Ananda Maima's husband, Bolanath, got the bad variety of smallpox, okay? Lethal. Lethal. And he was suffering terribly. And he finally asked her for help. He was a very proud guy, very proud. And he finally said, hey, okay, you know, I accept who you are. And then she took the pain away, the bliss. Her bliss took the pain away, as it were. Because he sort of said, okay, I think he said, I you know, there was some sort of transmission at that point where pain was gone. Even though he had smallpox and he died, she didn't take the death away of the body, but the pain was taken away. So people are going to suffer, but they don't have to suffer the pain of it so badly. Actually, there can be this grace of that, just like getting a severe mosquito bite, and it doesn't really itch. Doesn't itch that much, but they will get bitten for sure. The world is going to bite. It really is going to bite. Those who accept the relocation, no, they won't get bit. Mosquito doesn't like them. Doesn't like their blood. Doesn't want to taste the stalemate. It's got some kind of radiance in it. The mosquito says, no, that's kryptonite to the mosquito. It's toxic. Doesn't like that stuff. So, but others, they will get bit. They will get hammered. They will get sick. They will stress out. There's no question about it. But they'll feel an easement of it. They'll feel an easement of it. Like, you know what? I don't really have to suffer. Kind of a recognition will dawn upon them. Like, they'll sort of feel the stalemate. Like, hey, you know, what is this? There's something that is easing it up for me. There's something there. There's something. They don't understand it, really, because they have not clarified it. The work is ahead of them, and it's a tough work. That is for sure. The ego is very, very tricky. The mind, in the service of this idea of wanting to be prime creator, the mind is not at fault, of course. It is simply presenting the idea that we gave it. It's a servant, so it has to do this. But there will be an easement. So, that's kind of the bad news, good news situation of what we're in right now. But for me, I better relocate now, because people are going to start, around me, are going to start getting hammered for sure. For sure, it's on its way. Trouble is on its way. I can feel it, most definitely. sorts of miracles are possible. When there's someone in the world that has accepted this perfect stalemate, all sorts of miracles are possible. So many types of miracles are possible, of easements. Someone might have a little accident, but not so bad. Someone might have a little trouble, but not so bad. You know, it just, the whole thing eases up a little bit. It eases up. Again, do they deserve it? I mean, who am I to say? I mean, ultimately, of course. But it does put them into a situation where they have to start doing some work. They will naturally start saying, wow, something happened. What happened? What is that? So, yeah, you know, but that's a good thing. That's a good thing. So the island is within us, actually. It's within us. The secret island of bliss is within us, and we can actually relocate to that, turning our attention and accept the Holy Spirit, accept that the island is there. Step onto the island, as it were. Wade ashore and say, yeah. Or you can think of it as a huge cruise ship anchored, and we walk out to the cruise ship and board the cruise ship. It's there. We just simply have to do it. And then that will, you know, start bailing a lot of people out of really bad situations that they are in because of their fear of the continuity issue. And they're so afraid they cannot even try to deal with it. It's very difficult to even start. So I understand that. Most people have not even gotten started at all. It's just, it seems overwhelming to them. They're so frightened of it. It takes a real super determined effort and confidence to do this. You have to have, you know, actually, it's a good thing to become an egotist in this world first. It means you'll get a lot of confidence. I can do anything. And then turn that confidence towards seeing this, you know, this perfect stalemate. Turning that confidence in that direction. And then you can make a lot of headway, but it's very difficult. But still you think, you know what, I can do it. I can do it. Whereas if you just think, I can't do anything at all. You know, it may be very difficult to do it. So you might see some people, you think, oh, these people are such big egotists, unbelievable. You know, what terrible egotists. But later on, you'll find out they turn into saints because they use that determination and confidence and work ethic and all this stuff. They turn it in the right direction. Confidence and work ethic and determination and just refusal to be defeated. You know, you turn it in the right direction and then you've really got something. So time to actually relocate. That's what I would say. Time to actually relocate. That is my focus. That I'm focusing in on actually doing it. Actually doing it. In our relocation first. Most likely. I remember a dream I once had. I was on a big jet airliner. I've had so many incredible dreams. This is a big jet airliner. And we were just taxiing down the railway, the runway. We had to take off and we had to fly somewhere. It's very important. And we were escaping the world. And just before the plane took off, suddenly the pilot said, wow, we got a warning light. something wrong with the engine. We can't take off. And we braked and slowed down. And I was so upset. I said, we have to take off. This is a crazy delay, terrible delay. And from that point on, I've just been working so hard to fix what's wrong. How come the engine, something happened to the engine? What's wrong? So there must have been, the engine must have overheated before it took off. Out of fear, okay. So there was too much fear to actually take off. Overheated the engine. But at this time, right now, I'm trying to, I've tried to hopefully develop the engine to a point where it doesn't overheat. But I certainly have been having a great deal of nervousness, maybe because I'm ready to take off, to relocate, as it were, and I'm getting, maybe I have the jitters about the engine, having not been able to take off previously, almost, but not quite, nervous about whether the engine is going to overheat again. Whether I'm going to get too fearful of this and fail, but can't fail now, can't fail now, no way. the world is in free fall. Got to take off, got to relocate, so. I think maybe I'm just in my seat. And the plane is going down the runway, and I'm just getting all nervous, like, oh my gosh, what if it doesn't take off? What if it doesn't take off, It's like that. And say, pilot, please, engine, please. It's that kind of nervousness, like in a plane flight, when you're trying to take off and you're rattling down the runway, and it's just some people are afraid of flying, just praying, like, please, 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 safe takeoff, or landing, same way. But it's that feeling, like I'm jittery. About that, jittery about it. And there's like nothing I can do until the plane takes off. And when the plane takes off, it's like, I can finally relax at some point. But I would say that this experience now is just like that, taxiing down a runway. And there's an inner fear that the plane is going to overheat again. It might, but it might not. It really might not overheat this time. That is possible. And then if it doesn't, that's a very good thing. That's a very great thing. Because then you'll have someone that's airborne, that is relocated, as it were, here in the world. There'll be someone here that has actually done an inner relocation, still, though, in the world, presumably. Although it's possible an actual external relocation could happen, I don't know. But we'll just assume I'll still be in the world. Let's just assume that. That's a very great thing. Because people will start getting, bailed out. Really bailed out. You can't help it. I mean, it'll happen, simply happen. Because the radiance of the stalemate, it just radiates and spreads throughout the mind. It's there. And that will automatically lessen the intensity of the situation and move people closer to accepting a stalemate, a total stalemate. And maybe a lot of situations in the world will start getting stalemated because there is this great push by those who know the truth to try and help the world towards this perfect stalemate and not to get involved in a fight of defeat and triumph and all this kind of stuff, which that will lead to disaster. I guess so. Any moment, I may find myself, the plane airborne. Any moment, that is very possible. That's how I feel. I'm just waiting to see if it'll take off or not. So I'm just having to keep my mind calm, trying to calm myself down, because I don't know if I'm going to get airborne or not. I really don't know. Because last time I thought I was. I thought it for sure I was, and it didn't. But I was not nearly as well prepared then as I am now. Not nearly. But you never know. You never know. There might be some hidden stuff, you know? There might be. Might be some bad gasoline or something. And, so, let's find out what happens next. I regret, that's it.